comment? Nothing? We have approval of minutes.
I'll second.
All right, minutes approved. Start with old business, Sequoia cash flow projections.
All right, cash flow. So it's the sheet with the bar graph, says projected 17 cash flow. Just overview of the same thing, so still looking okay. Our reported in August was that we were behind in some of our revenue collections, most of the real estate taxes. As you can see in September, the lines have blinked in there as far as the colors. We do pick back up in our revenue projections. See, as far as what we're projecting to what we're actually brought in, it was, we picked it back up, so we're just about on task. So we put behind the bar graph at the actual projected versus actual. I'll just walk you really quick down to the bottom. The bottom block here says revenue received 5% budget cumulative. So we're actually about 0.1% ahead. You see there's a line there on September, so that's what we're looking at. We're about 0.1% ahead, which is good. So we're still on target as far as our collections. I do want to bring to the right of the sheet here where the expenditures by percent to budget, and we're actually 1.11% ahead. Over budget as far as our expenditures here to date right now. That's mostly due to wages, so we're still monitoring that to see where we end up. We did have some accounts payable that were due prior to when we're looking specifically the final bond payout for our EMAS bond, and that was $1.3 billion. So we are slightly ahead of where we projected as far as expenditures, but we expect that to smooth down the next 2 months. So we're looking good. State money is still flowing through, so we do know that Governor Wolf did approve some of the revenue package. So we are just looking to have some of that state funding that was lagging pick back up soon. So that'd be good. Any questions on that? Okay. We'll move to the budget to actual projections, and we're going to actually combine some of the new business items with this discussion because it's all relevant. We're going to combine essentially the fund balance projections, which is the fourth item on new business, with where we are. So it's the sheet that has Wyman-Sing Area School District fund balance report on it. It kind of looks like this. So we're going to go right to the fund balance. As reported last month, we're going to have a surplus about slightly over $1 million. The sheet you see here shows a surplus of $313,000. So we talked a little bit about that. The difference between the $313,000 and $1 million was because we had used some fund balance. The tune to $750,000 we transferred over to capital reserve, and about $30,000 we had reserved for instruments purchased. So we used that fund balance, we put it towards expense, and overinflated our actual expense per se that we had budgeted, because that was in fund balance. So I included that $810,000 in this to come down to $313,000. But as we walk down to the second part of the sheet, it will show you how much fund balance we actually are putting back into budget this year. So we're going to walk this through. If you have any questions at any time, please ask me. Okay, stop me right away and we'll just ask the question. So if we're going left to right, basically have the account code, what the description is. So we have basically five types of fund balance. We have non-spendable, which is essentially items that are kind of, they're due. It is more of an accounting procedure. They're there as far as they're items that are due, but we just, we have cash outlay, the cash was already spent, it's just like prior year items that are being cleaned up in the accounting system. The restricted fund balance, those are monies that we have yet to spend, so we collected revenue, for instance, Camp Carbizer. So there's a balance in that account, or in those monies that we collected, we didn't fully spend. So we restrict that cash specifically for that item. So you can see we have Camp Carbizer, La Crosse still has money that we're still spending now. The Wild Hill Citizens Group, they put money aside for, pay for instrument rentals, things like that. There's still some insurance money from some special ed books that are still, it's still hanging out there. And then we also have the fence donations, which is not on here. And it should be, I apologize, that should be on here. So for this, the stadium, that would be also included in this. We'll have that updated for sure. That was already sent to the auditors, it's not on the sheet. And then we have committed. So committed is, we're essentially saying that we're gonna put this money aside in these buckets for future spending. So as we know, we have stuff for capital reserve, we have curriculum enhancement, so the money that we're gonna be spending on the STEAM items, that's what this is for, or just replacement cycles for textbooks. Equipment, vehicle replacement. So we purchased the lawnmower out of this account 2 years ago. Peasers, so we reserved money for peasers for the impending need for that use when we have to balance the budget. And then there's some old accounts on here, capital lease payoff, which we did 3 years ago, the transportation software we purchased out of using fund balance. And then the equipment for the field house, which we purchased in 2017-18, that was committed in this account. And then instrument replacements, which we spent in 2016-17. So the committed fund balance, it's reserved for something, but we can also uncommit it if we need to use it for something else. It's not restricted. But we're just saying, for instance, that if we need to spend it here, we can. We can also uncommit it if we need to put it on the slide. Assigned fund balance is essentially what we're assigning fund balance to for the budget deficit from last year. The reason why it's only $322,000, that was what we're using out of the unassigned fund balance. The PISR's money, we'll talk about in a few minutes, what we used for that commitment to balance the budget last year. And then our unassigned fund balance is just undesignated funds that are just lying in there. And typically that has to be, for our size budget, the school is under 8%. So right now we're just under 8% as we're projecting here, slightly just under 8%. So that's that, the first, the left-hand side of this worksheet. The right-hand side, as we get to where we were as far as 6/30/16, that's where we ended the fiscal year 15/16. That was what was committed, restricted, assigned, and unassigned. In our financial statements. Now going further to the right, use the fund balance. So we transferred $750,000 into capital reserve. We used $30,000 for instrument replacement, and then we had essentially committed $356,000 to balance the 15-16 budget, which we didn't need. So that all goes back into fund balance to be essentially either committed or unassigned for the next fiscal year. We didn't really have any addition to fund balance, which is the next column, but then our fund balance changed. So this is what we're adding to fund balance for the 16-17 school year as of ending 6/30/2017. So I'm committing another $800,000 to capital reserve. We talked yesterday about some projects that we have coming up, Flannery Field, the 1965 section of this building. So I feel that we can commit another $800,000 to move over to capital reserve. I put $300,000 extra dollars into the curriculum enhancements to add to the STEAM projects that we would like to do, and or any of the replacement cycles coming up for our textbooks or just anything curriculum in general. I would put that balance up to $1.4 million. And then I, the residual, I added the $27,000 just to Peasers, just to put it in there. And we can move this money anyway, like, this is just my suggestion, just to get the ball rolling as far as the discussion. And then my unassigned fund balance is at $322,000. That was the portion that we used to balance the 16-17 budget. The reason why I did put the Peasers portion in there is because how the math worked, we didn't need that portion, also I left it in the Peasers and I didn't reduce that balance, so I actually added to that balance. So when it comes to all said and done, the $313,000, which is actually more than this, actually $1 million, we basically can work this way into that fund balance if we choose to. If we want to move those monies around, or if we have another initiative that we'd like to do, we'd like to specifically commit that money to, we can do that. But ultimately, the bottom line is revenues over expenditures. It's going to be about $1 million, which we reported in October, Finance Committee, as far as our surplus. So that's kind of where we stand right now. I know that was probably confusing as far as how the accounting works with that. Is there any questions on this at all?
I just have a clarification, because I know they're always trying to move money to, you know, for state. So for instance, when we talk to curriculum about the enhancements of us writing, which were more or less that type of
we'll talk about that today.
Yeah, which, does that come out of the first fund balance?
Sure. That those items, we could take a look at two different ways. So those items could be considered a capital purchase because they're an asset. It's tangible. We could do it out of there if we chose to. We could also use it for out of the curriculum. So when we first started talking about the 300 hallway, the wood shop area, we were going to use that to pay for that out of this, which is a curriculum part. Yeah. The capital reserve we're going to use to put aside as far as projects that more towards infrastructure for the buildings. But they could go out of both ways. We could swing it, you could make the case to do it out of either account. So when we start talking about what our capital list looks like, that's where this comes into play. So next meeting, which will probably be January, I'm assuming January 3rd, which is a Wednesday, we'll come back and show you the 5-year capital plan and how our commitment, whatever we commit to fund balance, how that now looks as far as the capital plan. So it kind of ties both ways to answer your question. If we have the money in capital reserve, we can probably take it out of there. If we decide to use that capital reserve money for more towards the Flannery Field / building improvements here and use the curriculum money for the STEAM, parts of this steam area, we can do a mixture too. So for instance, if we're purchasing maybe a piece of equipment that was directly steam related or curriculum related, we would take that out of there. If we're probably, you know, putting, you know,
just more question about that type
of thing. Yeah, like a desk or something. Even though that equipment would be an asset, it's more, you could make the case it's more tied directly to your curriculum. And then we would take maybe like the desk and chairs out of the capital reserve. Yeah, we could do that. But we also need to make sure that on our capital reserve list, because that list is pretty detailed and lengthy, we want to make sure we can, you know, sustain those projects too.
Right.
So although a lot of those, if we, and I'm sure you don't have to commit to memory, but there's a lot of projects that are related to Flannery Field that we're looking at doing with potential debt service, they would be shifted on that list where it wouldn't be tied to capital. So whereas once we said, well, we need capital reserve money to do this, like the infields for the baseball field or the dugouts, things like that, the scoreboard, we can shift that down to the debt service and use this more towards for the STEAM project.
So the conversation is over
our debt
service?
Okay. Yes, correct.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah, so the one thing, correct. And I just want to kind of layer that just with this important message. So just remember, once we move money from the general fund that we have for fund balance to capital reserve, you cannot move that thing. If it's in these buckets as far as commitment and we haven't quite moved that money yet, it's perfectly fine. We can rearrange it anywhere we want to. For instance, if you want to say, okay, instead of putting it in curriculum, let's just make a commitment for STEAM area or innovation area. We can say, okay, take $1 million from the curriculum, put that there, $400,000 left for the textbooks, in, specifically for textbooks and replacement cycles of that caliber. And then we have a line item that just says, you know, committed to STEAM project. You could actually do that if you want to. This stuff is flexible to a point. But remember, once we remove those funds and actually transfer them into the capital reserve account, into that capital reserve fund, they can't come back. Okay, so then we have to spend them on capital related items. Okay.
With that being said, are you comfortable with the figure $800,000 going into the capital reserve?
Well, I just put that there as a starting discussion.
Okay.
Yeah. So, like I said, like kind of what Maria had said, there are things we can take out of the capital reserve that would be capital items that would be related to the STEAM project. So, it is, once we move that money, it's not like it's like, oh, we can only do it for this type of project. No, it's capital projects. Capital projects can even be, you know, technology-related items. For instance, replacing a switch could be considered a capital project because of the amount of cost that it entails to replace a full switch. It's pretty expensive.
Well, I don't know what numbers we have with regard to the STEAM innovation project. I don't know. I mean, for example, if you can't move it out of there, do you want to put more in curriculum enhancement? You know, since we have flexibility with that, then with
we can. So what we need to do is, I don't need an answer on the fund balance right now.
Okay.
So when we need the answer on the fund balance, is going to probably, actually, I'm going to go backwards a little bit on that. So I just need some guidance right now because we're really close to having the audit done. So usually when we have the audit done, it was presented in what, January or February. This year we could actually be presenting possibly if the board chooses to, know the board, the elections are coming up. They actually weren't presented in December. So they're ready to go. We're almost done, which is great. We're ahead of schedule for our audit. So that's when we would actually need to have it solidified as far as where we want to put the funds. So I know that leaves November, 2 weeks in November to discuss this yet at our board meeting.
Since you have different people sitting here in December, you really want to dump that one out at that point?
We can wait till January.
Well, I don't know. Again, I'm not here. You guys are, you know, but I don't know that you want people here to make that decision and then people coming in for the board in December really knowing nothing because they're sitting there at reorg. They have no information whatsoever. They're not a committee meeting. Then voting on what we can do with this.
We can't wait till
January.
Yeah, that's fine.
My question is there like a financial benefit of having them, having something in the capital reserve fund that you can
There's actually no real benefit. The reason why that balance is high now is because I haven't been moving the actual cash over to getting a higher rate of return in our general fund because of volume. So taking that aside, the only benefit is that you're specifically designating that for capital improvements or purchases. So there is no true benefit monetary-wise, except that right now because of volume, I'm getting a better rate of return in the general fund. I'm just transferring it over as we need it. So that's why I didn't transfer over the whole amount right away, is because I get more interest rate.
Okay.
Yeah, but there is no true advantage for that. The only thing is the designation.
Okay.
Yeah. But Scott, I agree. I'm just excited that we're actually at the point where I'm gonna have a financial report ready by December, which is, to me, we met our goals. So, we can do that anyway. The auditor just suggested, hey, I can do this in December. I'm like, oh, yeah, that'd be maybe a good idea.
I just want to do what everybody else wants to do.
Yeah, but we can, so this is just the guys, we usually have this conversation later, and I want to start this now so that we can actually get some kind of discussion as far as what we want to do. We can always, essentially what this is as of June 30th, 2017, we're designating and committing the fund balance here. It's still flexible. So, you know, if we want to say, maybe we need to move some money here during the year, it is possible to make that transfer. So, I wouldn't get so focused as of the minutia, like, well, if this project's going to cost this, we should have this much. We do, just to let you know, the preliminary estimate cost of just the STEAM area in the junior senior high school, I think it's coming about $1 million. And that's, I think, with furniture. Okay, that was, I think it was $800 for the extra, just the architect. So it'll be a little bit more than that once we get the furnitures, if we would go with option two that was presented yesterday at facilities. Which was the original plan that we have been going with all along. So that kind of gives you a good ballpark of where we would be. We'd still have about $400,000 left. We can also, you know, dial back the capital reserve, say it's $700,000, put an extra $100,000 in there. It gives us a little bit more room. For instance, if we need to replace some, if there's some textbooks or curriculum that needs to be replaced because it's just overdue.
Well, I think what you're probably hearing, correct me if I'm wrong, is that people are a little bit nervous about putting a big chunk of money so they can't move it back and have no flexibility with it.
Sure.
You know, so is that kind of correct?
But we do have this fund. If it's construction related, okay, we can easily put it through the capital reserve.
You can use both funds.
Yeah,
some amount.
Some there.
Right.
I mean having the capital reserve is good because we do have a pretty hefty capital plan, you know, out there that when we took a look at, we're obviously not going to be able to fund all of that. We did reserve that up to six million of debt service, we might be looking to pull down at some point because of where we decide on Flannery Field for this project. So that it's still out there. Okay. So I think I covered the fund balance projections and the budget projections, actual 16-7. Any other questions on that at all? Their goal is to have this, have a meeting at the end of November to go over the financial report. So it would be you, Scott, and every board member there. If so, they would be going through and just doing the review of everything going over. We can wait till January to present. It also lies as well, depends on our meeting. So I think our meeting is second. The second Monday in December or the first Monday? If it's the first Monday, it's sixth, I think. She's actually booked, so maybe we can't do it that day. She is in Roxanne, right? But Roxanne said that we would be ready to go. So actually, I have a hard copy ready for everyone. In December, and when board orientation comes around, that would be the first thing we get to go over. Exciting. And then we can, in the first meeting in January, let's go to the business privilege tax update. So where we left off last month, Rob and I were going to meet with the borough of West Reading. We were going to meet with the borough of Wyomissing, and then we were going to meet with the Earned Income Tax Bureau. So we met with West Reading. We actually went to a their public meeting. They asked us to go there. All the council was there, the chief was there, everyone was there. It was great. Actually, had a pretty decent crowd turnout too, just for us. Actually, it wasn't for us, but it was, yeah. And we got to go over, kind of just gave them the description. They had a couple of questions, really great questions on it. We were able to answer a few of them. But they were going to have their solicitor review it and get either contact us or contact Clarence Cagle directly. I had not heard back from them. I need to follow up with them just to see where they are with that. Then we went and met with the borough of Wyomissing. We met with the borough manager, Marty Posey. We met with Michelle Bear, the zoning officer, was there. They had a councilman, John Woodward, was there. Phyllis, I can't remember last, the treasurer was there. So we went there, talked about it there. They essentially had some questions too, so we answered those questions the best we could. Their solicitor, I think, was already prepared to reach out to Clarence on it directly. So they're working on their end also. I then had a meeting with the Earned Income Tax Bureau, and that was a good meeting. That was good to meet Mr. Love. And they're also behind the regulations too. Essentially, what they said was, you know, whatever we decide to do, they will honor and put forth as far as how they collect the taxes. That was a great meeting with Mr. Love. Had a great connection with him, so I look forward to working with him on this in the future. The good part about that is the solicitor that they have is part of Cagle Kalanami and Court. So they were already talking a little bit about this, and Clarence and Attorney Conifer, who's their attorney, already started to discuss things about how the collection could take place. They're going to actually spot check some of the old forms that came in as far as what they need to fill out to report their business privilege tax and their earnings, and just see how the new regulations would apply to that. So I had some emails back and forth with Clarence on that. So they're going to be working on that. So the last part here, which we'll do this week, is to reach back out to UPG, say, look, this is where we are. Here you go. They should already be aware of most of this, and if we need to meet with them, we will. So that's where we stand right now. We're still shooting for hopefully that second meeting in November to get this on and to get it approved by our board. And hopefully all the dominoes fall after that in line. Everyone right now is on board. Nothing that was apparent, we did a great job explaining it. This is what it is. It's not changing the tax at all. It's not jeopardizing what you are already collecting. In fact, it could possibly bring in a little bit more. But we just need everyone on board to say, yeah, we are honoring this, and this is how, because it's a shared tax. So our tax reflects what they collect. Resolutions and ordinances are almost the same. And that was a message we put out there. Basically echoing everything that Clarence had provided in his presentation here. So, they were kind of understood at that point, and it was just, it's a long document to read, to get through. I think their attorneys are the ones that are running the ship now, so it's basically becoming a solicitor issue. So once we get this cleared up, get on board with UGs, we should be all good to go. Okay? And then from that point, I'll lead right into our next. I'm going to combine the next two, actually, the VF Allen Assessment Forecast and the Aqua Index Update all into one. So we're going to look at this sheet right here. A little background on this. about a month ago, Mr. Woodward, council member from the Rural Wyomissing, called me up and asked if we could have a meeting. I said sure, so he came over and discussed Equus Capital, who was the firm that purchased the VF Foundry Allens. He mentioned that they were appealing value on the properties, all the parcels that are located there. And that they would also like to meet to discuss the future of their purchase and the assessment value. The assessment appeal, I did go to the appeal meeting with the Board of Assessments, at which no one had showed up, so they basically said, okay, I can supply appealing it right away, which they did. And then when we met with them on the business privilege tax 2 weeks ago, they were invited to the meeting, ASA Equus, Mr. Haynes, and there was Mr. Flannery. We met with them and had a further discussion about what exactly are they're asking or trying to, the bottom line that they're trying to get to as far as their appeal of the assessed value. So essentially, we're looking at the top sheet here. And we'll walk through this left to right, top to bottom. So the five parcels that they purchased in our district are what you see here. The 801 Hill Avenue is obviously the main portion, all the buildings. The 739 Reading Avenue, it's listed there twice because that parcel was a split. The 915 Penn Avenue and the 800 Hill Avenue are all the parking areas. The 800 Hill Avenue actually is the location of where the McDonald's is right now. It will actually be the location of where Wawa will be in the future. Yeah, I'm not sure if they'll actually end up splitting that out, but at some point we could possibly be looking at a split of that parcel, which it would not affect us at all. This is
the parking lot of McDonald's located?
Yes, that whole big area.
So the corner right across from CNN.
Yep.
That's where the Wawa is.
Corner to corner, yeah. This way, that's that parcel right there.
The Park Road.
Yeah, no, correct. So you can see if we're walking left to right on the sheet, as of July. Yeah.
I'm sorry, the split. Is half of it parking, half of it building?
Yeah.
Okay.
I believe that might be the Reading China Glass building area. So the 801 Hill Avenue is all the blue building, red building, as we once knew it. Three buildings there, I believe. The 739 Reading Avenue is the other side, the parking China. 915, I think, is a parking.
Across from my house.
Yes. By Viva.
That's right there.
Okay, great. So as of July 1, 2017, the assessed value, total assessed value is $14.7 million on all the parcels. If you apply our tax rate at 30.065 mils, it comes out to $443,000 essentially that they pay in taxes. They did, like I said, they did appeal currently. They did appeal that.
So don't change the thing, it looks perfect.
Yeah, so far it looks great, right? It's a nice sum of money. Okay. So the next column over says new assessed value. So they did appeal the assessed value and they won per se. Point. So the assessed value was dropped down to $11.5 million, $11.59 million, which would be $348,000 would be the new tax levy, which was a reduction in tax revenue of $94,000.
So basically, even though they weren't there, the board looked at everything and still did recommend a lower assessment for
correct. Correct. Based upon the purchase price of what they purchased. The items in general, they did recommend a lower. They didn't meet halfway by any means because that's the next bottom portion of this analysis. So that was a 21.4% reduction in their assessed value. Going to the bottom of this sheet. So I'm going to pause right there for a second. We met with Equus at Borough Hall, and I'm trying to understand what their bottom line was at that meeting, was that they were looking get their assessment dropped down to what their purchase price was, fair market value. They said they're putting a lot of money into the property, that this would be a way to save some money on their part in order to put more money into the property in the future. Okay, so the bottom line was, this is what you're looking for. So built the analysis based upon what the purchase price was. The purchase price was $3.3 million. Now that purchase price included property of Wilson School District. So, which was the other side of the railroad tracks, okay? Which is a pretty big parcel of land in itself. So I had a prorate, I actually got the sale price per parcel from them. So I was able to kind of map this out for you today. So if you look at the bottom part of this section right here, the first part, once again, is our July 1st tax rolls. This is what we billed at $14.7 million. Now the proposed assessed value for our land would come down to $2.2 million. Okay, that means taxes levied would be $66,000, which means that would be a reduction of revenue for us for $377,000, which is about 85% reduction. Now, when we put this in terms, $377,000, it's just under one mil. It's just under half a mil. Okay, one mil is about $745,000, so it's about 0.49 of a mil. It's about 1% of our revenue budget. It is about 2.5 teaching positions. So that's total compensation, not just salary. So that's a pretty big bump of money right there. So yesterday, I had another meeting with Mr. Haynes, Mr. Flair, at VF. They're doing construction over there. It's definitely moving in direction. So trying to get further into what their actual ask is. So I presented this analysis, and this is where you're going. And I went through the whole thing. I'm like, you do realize that, over 1 year, it's $377,000. You combine it in 2 years, you're up over $7.5 million. $750,000. I mean, that's a pretty big gap for us. I then showed, if we turn the page, this chart. Now, this chart was presented in the budget presentation in May. It's our total assessed value history from the 11-12 school year, and I added the 18-19 school year on. Okay. So we were doing $817 million of assessed value in 11-12. In 13-14 is when the VF, once again, and the Highlands went through a reassessment. Battled it, they won to a point. And our assessed value dropped $21 million, 2.59%. So we went from $817 million to $793 million. They weren't aware of that. So I'm like, yeah, you can see where we were, now where we are. Okay? And then you can see that we never recovered from that point. Because we never had anything come in that would jump that back up at any time, any point in time. So we fast forward to the potential of 18-19. So they're looking at a reduction, another reduction, of 1.58% of the $12.5 million. Okay, now, according to them, this is going to be temporary, 2 years, for 2 year relief. And then what, according also to them, is that the assessed value should be higher than what it was between 13-14 and 17-18. So what they're going to put in. So they're looking for your temporary relief. What they're actually looking for is us to not fight the reassessment. That's interesting. And they understand to a point that this $377,000 a year is very important to us. I mean, it is very, very important to us. But they're also looking towards the future and saying that years, assessed value will be much, much higher. It will be higher than where you were before they rolled their assessment back in the VF. Because we know the VF is basically our largest tax payer. That's the thing. So we'll get to that point. So they're going to be putting in, I asked the question, how much are you putting into the property? we can't really answer that question. $70 million is what I heard. That's a lot of money. Now, that's not what the assessed value is going to be, because even if you took $70 million and you took it times which it, when something sells, so for instance, if a hotel would sell in the district and you know, it would sell for $100 million, you'd have to apply the common level ratio to it at 0.729%. And then that common level ratio would technically become the assessed value of that property if no one fought that.
Well, I mean, here's the point. You know, if we agree to this, what are they giving us? What do we get in return for saying, okay, we won't fight the assessment? What do we get?
That's exactly right. We can make a decision anyway.
I just don't see how we benefit by saying, sure, because they had an assessment appeal back in, what was it, 2014, they had their appeal.
Yeah.
So are they going to try to convince the board or a judge that in 3 years this property decreased in value from 14.78 to 2, you know, in 3 years like magic, it just went down that much in value? I mean, how are you going to prove that?
That's what they claim. That, of course, their assessor or came in and said, this is how much this property is worth. So this is how much they got to buy, which is not the whole story.
No.
Keep going.
Well, I just don't see if they're saying, hey, be nice to us, give us 2 years of worth of tax relief, and then you're going to get a bonus at the end. I guarantee you that if our appraiser comes in 2 years and says it's worth $30 million, they're going to have somebody come in and say, "Oh, it's only worth 17," which means they're not going to just agree to whatever our appraisal says on the back end of this thing. They want us to agree on the front end, and I just don't see how that benefits us at all. I think they're going to have a hard time getting to that level of the judge when they were just there 3 years ago. You know. I mean, frankly, I'm surprised they got what they got from the board. Frankly, I don't know. Who knows? But I don't think we should scroll over on this. There's no benefit to this.
I agree. So I asked a couple of questions. I asked the time frame, which I didn't get any answer on. It was 2 years. They expect this to be done in 18-19.
Okay.
I asked
that
how much are
4 years.
I asked how much you put in, but didn't get an answer on that. I also let them know, they also asked, well, if we were to, the conversation went many different directions. It went from anything to, I think you should have a separate rate for commercial property for your village and residential. Because they start to go into the price per square foot. I'm like, that's not what we're hearing. Discuss really, and then the conversation went in many different directions. The bottom line is that they're looking for temporary relief in hopes that the, and then I also asked, well, what are your chances are, I asked that question, if you're going to fight us if the appeal is too high, and the answer didn't really come out. And then I said to them, by the way, you do know that I can't hedge future. I can hedge this board decision for future board decisions, meaning that I can't control what's going to happen in the future with a new board coming in. If they come back and say this property is valuable, we want to set spot assessment, they want to do it, we're still in our means to be able to do that. And we can go in and fight the assessed value on this. You're like, okay, I'm like, that's the board's decision 1, 2, 3 years from now. New board comes in. So I can't control that. There's no written guarantee at all on this. We can't do a written guarantee. The only thing to say is that you have this current board's word that they will come back and reassess you at any point. That's for a couple months. So I think they understood that, but definitely stress that we can't do any type of written agreement on this. It just has to be. Yeah, we won't fight your assessment, but I can't guarantee that either.
When was this new assessment, 11.5?
That happened in August.
This past August?
Yeah, so there are deadline to officially submit their... The deadline officially to support the, to submit the appeal is the 4th of November. So, Saturday, which would be Friday.
So they're going to submit an appeal?
Yeah, they already did. Yeah.
Well, what's our time frame?
Want to fight it? I think we would have to, once they submit, I believe we would have to do so now. Because they have to submit their appeal and it has to be, I guess, accepted by the...
I got it. I'm not familiar with those procedures at the appeal level. You know, I would imagine if they file an appeal, the court, what's going to happen is the court's going to schedule a status conference. But I think what they would do, where the parties come up and say, listen, where are we at this thing? I think obviously what I would suggest we do is get an appraisal. You know, I don't think we should roll over on this. This is too much money. Simply roll over. You know, this really impacts our budget in a very negative fashion. There's no guarantee we're going to get it back in. So I think we just have to get an appraisal. Just put that straight up. And hey, if our appraisal says this is right, okay. You know, there are certain.
Okay. I already have emailed all this to Howard, so I will get a hold of him and we'll start that process. And hopefully have something.
Do we have to go through those steps? Do we have to pay through appraisal and all that kind of stuff, or is it?
Yeah.
So we do. So I guess the question is, so we just have to kind of prove to the courts that we're not in favor of this production.
Well, we have to prove to the courts what fair market value is.
Then why should we have to fight?
Well, because if we don't find this, we just have one person going, and they kind of say, here it is, there's no opposition. The court's going to say, well, okay, if nobody cares, I guess we don't either.
I mean,
sure.
I just hate that we have this.
Yeah, I mean,
I know,
but this...
You know, we want to have nice relations with them, I get that, but at the same time, we are a public school system, we don't have the ability to give them a break for 2 years. Unless they want to just come in and physically write a check for our teachers that we're going to lose.
Those are all points that I made clear to them. He said, we want to be business friendly. We want business in here. The board is very business friendly. We're very excited about the prospects of having this whole complex in our district. It's going to be pretty big. It's going to be very significant in the future. But we also have to maintain, you know, what we're doing now. A lot of your property values resolve around how well your school district does in the ranking, and you know, it's out there that we're a good school district. People want to live in this area, and that all helps property value. It helps their property value. So I stressed all those things to them. They understood it to a point. I mean, they're in the business. They understand the other side of this. This is not their first rodeo. It's not ours. So you know, it's going to come probably down to that requirement. I think go for an appraisal and see what it comes up, and it will probably be somewhere between. Maybe it's the second set of numbers of where the assessed value is as of today. Maybe that's where it lies. They already got a savings of. And that's another question I asked. They said, well, how far do you want this to roll back? Do you want this rolling back to July 1? Or do you want to just go forward? They said, we would be looking to have it go back to July 1, so we'd be issuing a refund of at least $95,000. So at the minimum right now, that's what we would be issuing back, which $95,000 is a lot of money. Don't get me wrong, it's not $377,000. So that's where we stand. I will contact Howard, get this ball rolling with him, and see what he says, and then I will start sending updates out to the board on this. The PERO essentially is letting us take the lead because we're the largest taxing entity here. So the county has really not any say in it because they can't do assessments on the Department of Assessments can, but the county can't dictate what happens on like the PERO and the district can. So we're we're kind of the lead, we're kind of the lead on this. And they're gonna follow basically what we do. The borough obviously has a stake in the game on all the parcels, but they have less revenue to lose because just of how their mortgage is set.
But they're about six.
They're very low. They're lower, yeah, they're lower than West Red. West Red, I think, is at six, and the county's at seven.
So they're like 10% of us, you know, so it's like they just don't have it. Yeah, well, when they look at it, they say, we're the ones with all the money to lose, so we're going to fight it tooth and nail, and they just benefit from our fight.
Correct.
They never control it.
Correct.
So I'm just nearly confidential about this. This is
something
too, so.
For this issue right here. Yeah. No, I talked to them as we discussed it. So this, as far as actual worksheet going out, not talked out, is fine. And then there's a third sheet to this, which we're going to go into. Do I have any more questions on this assessment in the direction that we're heading in? So we're okay with contacting Howard and starting this ball rolling in the direction of basically fighting the impact. Oh yeah, we'll get some opinion on that. So going into the next part, so there's a forecast, which essentially we're going to be focusing on the column that says 2019. I put this projection together. This projection right here, if we're looking at the top part, going left to right. The budget right now, the 2017-18 budget, so the year up top represents the last end of our fiscal year, so it's 2017-18 budget. The next column is our 2019 very preliminary budget already. We are looking at a slight loss, but this budget, this forecast, I already took out the $377,000. I want to show you what it looks like. $377,000 is already out of this. Shows a 0% tax increase. So right now, our budget set for the 18-19 school year is at 0% tax increase with $377,000 in tax revenue already happening. So very preliminary numbers, but it kind of goes into our next conversation as far as Act 1 and our exceptions. So Act 1 has the index set at 2.4%. That's what our index is. Some districts are a little higher. Ours is not. We're at the base. So we can raise the taxes up to 2.4%. There is the possibility, as always, that there's four exceptions out there that we can apply for, run the numbers to see if we can get any further relief if we need to raise our tax millage above 2.4%. When I ran the special ed numbers, we don't qualify because we're special ed. Expenditures are doing pretty well. Next year might be a different story. And our PISRS numbers are very insignificant. So I know typically we don't go for the exceptions. So this year would be probably no different, I'm assuming. Plus we don't qualify for one of them. So the ability for us to raise above 2.4% isn't that great to begin with. So what does that mean? So with the budget timeline that we have to do, if we were to apply for a PISR or a retirement exception, we would need to put forth a budget by the end of January and put it out for inspection, do all the work that we normally do in April, May, and June, and schedule. If we do not want to go for the exceptions, we can put forth a resolution saying we're not raising taxes above 2.4%, and then we're on our normal course into May. So I'm going to get this resolution together and we'll have it the second meeting in November to say that we're not raising taxes above 2.4%. So last year at this time, just for perspective, we were above $1 million as far as the budget gap. We got that closed up to under $1 million. So I don't see anything different. These are very preliminary numbers that you're seeing here right now. And it's almost worst case, doomsday scenario. I know that would be just added money as far as a surplus. So we're going to be very conscious once again as far as where our tax rate is. Plus, I just, you know, told someone that we're very tax friendly, we are business friendly, and we're looking to keep business in the Columbus area school district. So we're going to, you know, put forth the pencil to the paper and make sure that we can, you know, put a budget together that, you know, takes into consideration all the board's goals. And right now you're seeing the very narrow part of that discussion. But I wanted to get this out to you now because, once again, I've never had this in November. This is the first day, it's still kind of October. But we are starting this process already. We will have these numbers updated as we go along, especially with how staffing is kind of going and just, you know, the constant shuffle throughout the year. But right now we're at that $2.4 million, you know, gap right now. We will get that coming up. Questions on that? That's not here. So that would be out of the 17-18 budget. Yeah, so the 94 would come out of this year's revenue. So when you look at cash, you look at, you know, we'll have a little bit more of an unprojected decrease.
Right.
That, you know, so,
that would be.
Yeah. Well, you know, I try and control everything. That's my job. But. Any other questions on? No, we've been covering a lot of deep things. But any questions? If you do have questions, you think they're just email me or call me. Let's go into. Let's wait for the West Reading. We'll do that at the end. Is that okay? Okay. The technology upgrades for the hills. So, as you know, we have the one-to-one. School, and we have started the pseudo one-to-one or technology increase at West Reading, which I believe is going very well. Now the third part of our phasing project is the hills and their technology, and we'll call it an enhancement rather than a one-to-one because some of the grades would be not necessarily one-to-one, they would be 2-to-1 in kindergarten to 2, and then 3 and 4 would be more of a hybrid one-to-one. So what we had budgeted, we're going to go for at least through Apple again. That's the recommendation because the interest rate is really low through Apple Technologies. And then plus that piece puts us on a schedule, a replacement schedule going forward. So every 3 years we know that we're refreshing our equipment, we're refreshing the piece to go with it. Kind of helps us budget it much better doing it this way. And since it's essentially 0.9% financing, it's almost borrowing free money. So we're going to go forward with that again. We're going to put the lease on. The lease is slightly over what we had budgeted. So we budgeted $68,000 and we have two proposals. I guess it's basically the difference in the carts that we're purchasing for the area. The one proposal is at 75 and one proposal is at 77. So essentially we're about $7,000 to $9,000 above what we budgeted, which we can absorb in our budget cap. And that's a lease payment for the year. So the total cost would be about anywhere from $224,000 to $229,000. And that would cover K to 4 with the carts in the rooms, with the cases, with the devices, and also purchase. That's it for right now for this lease. Yes?
Just a quick question. So our students from 7 through 12 purchase a insurance policy.
Yes.
Case. 5 and 6 don't bring it in. K through 4 will not.
That's correct.
However, how are we covered for insurance for those devices? If, you know, I should assume that we have insurance, but we don't have, ask the families to cover the insurance,
yeah,
correct?
That's correct. Our policy covers our devices. The reason why we do charge that is because they are taking the role. Now, there doesn't mean that we can't alter that at all. If there's a small fee for those that are handling in the school, we can discuss that going forward, but right now our policy is just, if you're taking the device home, you get to pay for the insurance.
And do we have a policy or fee in place if a child can get from K through 6 damages? Yeah, like I know that if my, the book, I paid $50 for some book that wasn't bound properly when my son came back. So the question is, like, what do we do if a child, like, literally takes an item